quite a ways into this essay on the ontological mystery, Gabriel Marcel now introduces some of the other key themes of his work, and he's bringing them all together in a knot around the conception of mystery and what it involves for us as human beings, as human subjects, as inquirers, as questioners. So we've moved from the problem, or the realm of problems, the realm of objectivity, where there are decided techniques for resolving them, for framing them, where it doesn't really matter what individual is engaged with them, into what he calls the meta-problematic, meaning we're rising to a higher or deeper level in which the problematic itself can be understood, but from which, from the perspective of the problem, the mystery doesn't actually make sense. This realm can't picture, can't understand this realm. And within the mystery, one of the most distinguishing characteristics of a mystery in the sense that Marcel uses it is that, as he says, in a mystery, the problem encroaches upon its own data, and the primary way in which it does so is by involving and engaging the subject, him or herself, in the very problematic, rendering it no longer something that can be resolved by some definite technique or set of techniques within the realm of objectivity, once and for all and for all people, but it's something that requires the subject to actually look at him or herself and his or her own involvement with the very issue that they're trying to make sense of. And he says that it comes with a kind of certainty or assuredness that it provides. So he says, there's a question, you know, that somebody asked, this meta-problematical of which you speak is after all a content of thought, something that we can think of. How then should we not ask ourselves, what is its mode of existence? What assures us of its existence at all? How do we know that we're not just barking up, a fictitious tree here? Is it not itself problematical in the highest degree? And he says, here's where Marcel actually lays his cards on the table. My answer is categorical. To think, or rather to assert, the meta-problematical is to assert it as indubitably real. Not in the sort of sense that you could not logically conceive of its alternative or its lack or something along those lines. He doesn't mean certainty in that sense, the indubitable of, say, Descartes. What he means instead is that it provides itself to us. It gives itself, you might say, phenomenologically, with a kind of inescapable presence. We realize that we are in the face of something that we cannot simply push away from ourselves. He says, because this idea is certainty, it is the assurance of itself. It is, in this sense, something other and something more than an idea. It's a reality. As for the term content of thought, we want to liberate ourselves from this notion of content of thought, which ultimately is coming from experience. And he says, part of what we do when we're actually doing philosophy, if we're doing this kind of philosophy, is liberate or detach ourselves from our own experience, our own structures of thought. And he says, this liberation must be real. This detachment must be real. They must not be a mere abstraction. Much of our thought that we bandy about with, and particularly when we're in the realm of the problem, is still mere abstractions. We want to think the concrete that is yet not at the same time the concrete of sense experience, but the concrete of lived, engaged experience. So he says, this brings us to recollection, which is a very important concept for Marcel. And he says, this is again something that's not easy to wrap your head around, not easy to provide clear characterizations of that are going to apply across the board at every point. This is the opposite of philosophy by definition, where we begin from, clear, indubitable starting points or axioms and then build our way outward. We're engaged in the process of inquiry, and we have to sort of try to make our best sense out of what we encounter along the way. Recollection is one of these ideas, and he says, philosophers have really not paid very close attention to it. So he says, I am convinced, for my part, there is no ontology, that is to say, no apprehension of ontological mystery, except to a being who is capable of recollecting himself and of proving that he is not just a living creature pure and simple, that is a creature at the mercy of his life and without a hold upon it. And he wants to say that this notion of recollection not only is a second form of reflection, which we'll get to in a moment, but it has two sides to it. And he actually invokes, in the French, he invokes the English term recollection. And he says, within recollection I take up my position, or rather I become capable of taking up my position. In regard to my life, I withdraw from it in a certain way. When we're recollecting, and he doesn't just mean remembering, but something a bit deeper here. He says this is actually the basis for memory. When we're recollecting, we're gathering ourselves back into ourselves. He says, I carry with me that which I am, and perhaps my life is not. I am more than my mere life. I am more than just the memories that I carry around with myself. I am more than just the capacities. I am a person. This is part of what it means to be a person. So he says, recollection is not the same thing as dialectical turning to itself, as in German idealism. To withdraw into oneself, he says, is not to be for oneself, nor to mirror oneself the intelligible unity of subject and object. It's something different than that. He says, on the contrary, I would say that here we come up against the paradox of the actual mystery. The mystery itself is not something, when we're dealing with a mystery, like the mystery of evil, the mystery of the relation between the body and the soul, the mystery of these chance encounters that turn out to be determinative for our life, we're dealing with something that is a paradoxical structure. That's part of why it can't be unraveled easily into a problem. And recollection itself has a paradoxical sort of structure to it. So he says, you are not your own. That's one of the things that's revealed to us in recollecting ourselves, in bringing ourselves back to a sort of unity. We realize that we brought something else in and that we don't entirely belong to ourselves. So he goes on and he says, this is where the second reflection comes in. He says, we are here at the most difficult point in our whole discussion. Rather than speak of intuition in this context, we should say we're dealing with an assurance which underlies the entire development of thought, even of discursive thought. It can therefore be approached only by a second reflection. What is the first reflection? The first reflection is where I become aware of myself as involved in the very problems that I am setting myself, and I move into a meta-problematic of the mystery. The second reflection, he says, is whereby I ask myself how and from what starting point I was able to proceed in my initial reflection. I think, how is it that I'm actually able to move from this to this? The second reflection, he says, is recollection in the measure in which recollection can be self-conscious, which means that much of the time that we're engaged in this thing that Marcel calls recollection, we're not actually conscious of it. It's something that we do. It's, you might say, in other terms, it's almost like a transcendental condition of philosophizing or of thinking in general or of reflecting in general. So, he says then, this leads us to looking at what do we call the dramatic aspect, he says. The most dramatic movement in the rhythm of consciousness seeking to be conscious of itself, it is this dramatic aspect which must be brought out. So what does Marcel mean in speaking of a dramatic aspect of all of this? If you think about what drama consists in, Aristotle talks about this and he says drama involves action, and it's coming from the term dran, which is a imperative, meaning to act, to do. Now, whenever we have action, What has to occur in order for action to be able to occur? Choice. So these are all connected with each other. And when we make choices, we should try to avoid being misled by examples of like choosing something off of a menu, you know, when we're going to eat, or being in a particular situation and merely choosing the road A or the road B. There's always consequences to choices, and we may not realize them at the beginning, but we're also committing ourselves, not only the part of ourself that's making the decision, but the rest of ourself. That's the interesting thing, by the way, about the will, is that it is the instrument that moves all the other instruments, as St. Anselm would say. What goes along with the capacity to choose? For human beings, the capacity to choose means the capacity to choose the good or to choose the bad. Otherwise, it doesn't really make sense. Ultimately, not every choice is a choice between the good and the bad. There's choices between different goods. There's trivial choices. But on a fundamental level, we can say that the dimension of choice involves deciding for oneself, am I going to go this way or am I going to go this way? And Marcel is going to think of this in terms of things like betrayal, despair. He says despair is possible in any form, at any moment, and to any degree. And if this betrayal may seem to be counseled, if not forced upon us, by the very structure of the world we live in, the deathly aspect of this world may, from a given standpoint, be regarded as a ceaseless incitement to denial and to suicide. When we're talking about the existential drama concerning a person's not only their life but their very being, these are all possibilities, and they remain possibilities throughout a person's life, throughout a person's capacity for choosing as it's actualized. What it would be the opposite of those? He's not going to tell us right away, but these are really going to be forms of the theological virtues. He's not going to call them as such. He's going to do the analyses of these. He's not even going to use the same words. He's going to talk about fidelity rather than faith and availability rather than charity. But we're going to see that it's going to fit into that structure. And the choices involved in a human life, the most determinative choices, the concern with this drama that has to do with the ontological mystery, are the between these, he says. So he says, that's why I like to write plays. That's why I like to read plays. That's why I go to operas, Marcel is saying. He says, it may be surprising to find in the course of this calm and abstract reasoning words so emotionally charged as suicide and betrayal. They're not a concession of sensationalism. He says, I am convinced it is in drama and through drama that metaphysical thought grasps and defines itself in concreto. So it's through drama, not that metaphysics, but that metaphysical thought. Why? Because who does metaphysics? The human person. And this dramatic aspect of our being is just as much a part of our being as is the fact that we think. As a matter of fact, this pervades this. You can understand any philosophy as really the working out of this path or the working out of this path. Remember back a little bit before this, he talked about an inhuman philosophy along with inhuman social conditions. An inhuman philosophy would be ultimately a choice for this. So this is all within the realm of the mystery, whether the mystery is understood as such. So he goes on and he says, if I have stressed despair, betrayal, and suicide, it's because these are the most manifest expressions of the will to negation as applied to being, as applied to the ontological mystery. And now he's actually going to do analyses, and each of these analyses is going to oscillate back and forth between these, we could say, high points, these affective attitudes, these choices, and these on the other hand. So we want to look at each of these in turn, starting with not faith, but hope. In his analysis of hope and what hope has to tell us about the ontological mystery, about the nature of our being, about our engagement with being, Marcel is going to start out by talking about despair. And I put a question mark here because we want to actually follow out this movement that he's going to trace, a critical opposition to other ways in which people have thought about hope. First of all, let's begin with despair. He says, I have in mind the act by which one despairs of reality as a whole as one might despair of a person. Despair is something that is felt not just towards being, but to being in a personal way. So he says, this appears to be the result or the immediate translation of a kind of balance sheet. We tally up what's possible or what's conceivable for us, and then we say, it's not going to work. It's not enough. And we can despair of a relationship. This will never be what I want it to be. He or she will always behave in this way, will never change, will never listen to me, will never accept who I am. I will always be forced into wearing a mask in dealing with this person. That's one mode of despair. I'm too old to learn things that I now recognize as being valuable, essential, vital to me as a human being, not only in my career, but for who I am. That's one reason why, you know, somebody like Epictetus says, it's never too late to learn philosophy. He's counseling against despair. And Marcel has this metaphor of the balance sheet, and he says, I can find nothing in it that withstands that process of dissolution at the heart of things which I've discovered and traced. He's talking about what he discussed earlier. I believe at the root of despair, there's always this affirmation. There is nothing in the realm of reality to which I can give credit. No security, no guarantee. It is a statement, and I love this expression, of complete insolvency. Hope, on the other hand, is a kind of credit. He says it's what implies credit. And here's where the question mark comes in. He says, contrary to what was thought by Spinoza, and we could think of quite a few other people, Spinoza is actually following Descartes in this, and they're not the only people to view things this way. Spinoza, he says, seems to me to have confused two quite different notions, distinct notions. Fear is correlated to desire and not to hope. Spinoza correlated, and again, many other people, Hobbes, you know, Descartes, correlated hope and contrasted it against fear. So hope is sort of the opposite of fear. Fear is a lack of confidence in you know, things turning out the way that you want them to turn out. And when it becomes particularly acute, then, you know, it turns into despair. And when hope becomes particularly pressing, it becomes confidence and then becomes, you know, absolute assurance. And Marcel says that's actually not the right way to think about it. Because what is fear really correlated with? Or contrasted against? Fear is really contrasted better against desire. And this is a very Augustinian way of looking at things. If you if you read St. Augustine, you will see him, you know, in the Confessions, in the On Freedom of the Will, in the City of God, contrasting these as basic motivations for human beings. Marcel says that the opposite of hope is despair, not fear. And he's going to do something with this that I want to show you in just a moment. So he says, hope consists in asserting that there is in the heart of being, beyond all data, beyond all inventories and calculations, a mysterious principle which is in connivance with me, which cannot but will that which I will, if what I will deserves to be willed, and is in fact willed by the whole of my being. So what he's saying is that there is an ontological difference of dimension or level. This is actually going to be at the level of the mystery. And it takes us beyond the realm of the problematic, which remains the realm of fear and desire. Hope, like he said, and I want to go back over this. It says, hope consists in asserting that there is, in the heart of being, so in reality, beyond all data, beyond the realm of objectivity, beyond all inventories and calculations, which again are matters of fear and desire, a mysterious principle which is in connivance with me, a mysterious which cannot but will that which I will. So, you know, if I will this, then there's something in being beyond me that I can't quite put my finger on that is actually going to help me out, that's going to make that happen. Two important provisos. One is, if what I will deserves to be willed, and if it is willed by the whole of my being. There we're in the realm of the mystery. So he says, we've come now to the center of what I call the ontological mystery, to hope against all hope that a person who I love will recover from a disease which is said to be incurable, is to say, it is impossible that I should be alone in willing this cure. It is impossible that reality in its inward depth should be hostile or so much indifferent to what I assert is itself a good. It is quite useless to tell me of discouraging cases or examples. Beyond all experience, all probability, all statistics, I assert that a given order shall be reestablished. Now notice, it's not just a shot in the dark or a leap of faith over some gulf into, you know, pure irrationality. A given order will be reestablished. Brokenness will be healed. So this is the prophetic tone of true hope. And he says, no doubt I shall be told, in the majority of cases this is an illusion. But that's precisely why hope is something different. Hope does not count up the cases. And that's why he says hope is particularly associated with the will as a faculty rather than just sheer desire. The will, in fact, also sort of jumps over this thing, like he says, and doesn't count the costs, doesn't tally up the cases. And he goes on to say that between hope, the reality of hope in the heart of the one whom it inhabits, and the judgment brought to bear on it by a mind chained to objectivity, there exists the same barrier. There's a barrier as that which separates a pure mystery from a pure problem. So he says, this brings us to a very important point of our subject, where certain intimate connections can be traced. The world of the problematical, he says, is the world of fear and desire, which are inseparable. At the same time, it is the world of the functional. We talked about this earlier. It is finally the kingdom of technics. of one sort or another. And by this he means techniques, in both in the sense of the intellectual techniques and in the sense of, you know, ways of producing things. So science and technological progress is all within this realm. And he says, every technique serves or can be made to serve some desire or some fear. Conversely, every desire, as every fear, tends to invent its appropriate technique. And this applies to things ranging from medicine, which, I, by the way, I'm not knocking, all the way to things like developing deodorants. You know, think about the relation of desire and fear in that. You know, and we even have advertisements to get this stuff across. You know, buy this deodorant or you're going to stink and people won't like you. Appeal to fear. Want to get in, you know, with this person or a mate like them? Then you need to get this product because that will fulfill your desires. And, you know, we can come up with innumerable examples of these sorts of things. Now, what about despair? He says, from this standpoint, despair consists in the recognition of the ultimate inefficacy of all techniques. When we develop all these techniques, and we say, yeah, we're going to make this work and make this work, and we've got this way to resolve this, and we can stave off the fear with this product or this technique or this discipline. When we think it through, we actually realize, well, you know, we're kind of just papering over the void. These things do, in fact, fail. You know, here's a great example. I've got one of these Fitbits now, and it's counting how many steps I take and how active I am. And it's supposed to be part of a process that, you know, is really still at the level of fear and desire of my getting healthier by being more active. And it's going to chart this stuff. And, you know, there's interesting articles saying, well, you know, the raw data by itself isn't going to help you. You need some sort of program to make sense of it for you. Not really sure about that. Is this going to improve my life in real, meaningful, who I am, what my purpose here is, what the hell this is all about kinds of ways? No. If it's going to improve my life, it's going to be at this level. And if I expect it to improve my life at this level, I'm really stupid and benighted and imprudent. Because it's not going to be able to do that sort of stuff. Yet people do this over and over and over again. If I can just get this thing, if I just apply this technique, I will actually be happy, or I will quit being so friggin' miserable, and everything will fall into place. Marcel is saying that, look, that's not going to be the case, and the realization that that is our condition can bring about despair. The fact that techniques actually do end. That they can't provide us with everything that we want. And he goes on and he says, we seem to have entered upon the very era of despair. We have not ceased to believe in technics, that is to envisage reality as a complex of problems, yet at the same time the failure of technics as a whole is discernible to us as its partial triumphs. At least those who are paying attention. To the question, what can man achieve? We continue to reply, he can achieve as much as his technics. Yet we're obliged to admit that these techniques are unable to save man himself, and even that they are apt to conclude the most sinister alliance with the enemy he bears within him. And think about all the different ways in which we have been horrific, not just horrible, but horrific to humanity by the use of technologies and techniques and within the realm of the objective. Then think of the more banal ways in which we've, you know, caged in other people and ourselves through these things as well. Marcel reflects on this for a moment and he says, I've said man is at the very mercy of his techniques. This must be understood to mean that he is increasingly incapable of controlling his techniques. And he has a brilliant formulation here. We're incapable of controlling our technology, of controlling what it does to us, of controlling the effects that it produces, which means that we're incapable of controlling our own control. Because techniques are ways in which we control things. I monitor my footsteps. Now I have control over that. I can say, aha, yesterday I didn't walk enough. Today I walked enough to make up for that. The lack of control means that we lose control over our very means of controlling. And that's scary as hell. But going beyond mere fear of, you know, Skynet taking over or something like that is a sense of, I really don't know what it's about. I can't seem to get things back together, to put, to use another Marcellian phrase, to put the broken world back aright. That is despair. That's something deeper. And he goes on and he says, this control of his own control, which is nothing else than the expression on the plane of active life, what I have called thought at one remove, cannot find its center or support anywhere except in recollection. So what he's implying here, and this is a bit of a digression, is that our concerns about technology and science and how we ought to think about it will not actually lead us to anything other than despair unless we can learn to recollect in the way that, that Marcel is talking about, which attaches us, reattaches us to the ontological mystery. So, he says, it will be objected that even those whose faith in technics is strongest are bound to admit there exist enormous realms which are outside man's control. But what matters is the spirit in which the admission is made. We recognize we have no control over meteorological conditions, but the question is, do we consider it desirable and just that we have such control? Notice a question that he's asking that all too often those who are pushing the envelope with technology are missing. He doesn't just say, is it desirable? Is it just? Is it right? Is it good? Which is something different than whether it's desirable. He goes on. The more the sense of the ontological tends to disappear, the more unlimited becomes the claims of the mind, which has lost it to a kind of cosmic governance, because it is less and less capable of examining its own credentials to the exercise of such dominion. And he goes on to say, some people might argue, look, technology is really a matter of hope. An expression of the kind of hope that you were talking about. And you know, if you he doesn't say this here, but if you think about it, if you look at the development of technology and you read the biographies of some of the people who actually did develop it, not just technology in the sense of machinery or apparatus, but the ones who actually carried out the theoretical, conceptual, intellectual work as well, and had argued their positions, many of them did have this sort of hope that, you know, I will, in fact, be able to make sense of things. The universe or whatever, something in being will cooperate with me if what I actually intend to pursue is, in fact, what ought to be pursued. It's not for nothing that a lot of the early scientists, you know, were, in fact, religious figures. Something that a lot of, you know, polemicists seem to forget about today. So he says, it'll perhaps be said this optimism of technical progress is actually animated by great hope. How is hope in this sense to be reconciled with the ontological interpretation of hope? Here's where he says something really interesting. He says, here's my answer. Speaking metaphysically, the only genuine hope is hope in what does not depend on ourselves. Hope springing from humility and not from pride. So, he brings in some other terms here. Pride is really connected with despair, not with hope. It says this metaphysical problem of pride or hubris, which is perceived by the Greeks and which has become one of the essential themes of Christian theology, has been almost entirely ignored by modern philosophers other than theologians. But from my own standpoint, he says, it's an essential, if not the vital question. it's sufficient to, and here's bashing Spinoza again, to recall Spinoza's definition of superbia, or pride, in his ethics, to see how far he was from grasping the problem. Pride is an exaggeratedly good opinion of ourselves which arises from self-love. And he says, you know, that's not actually even the definition of pride, that's the definition of vainglory, something different but related to pride, something that flows from pride. As for pride, it consists in drawing one's own strength solely from oneself. The proud man is cut off by his own choice from communion with his fellow men, which pride, acting as a principle of destruction, tends to break down. And pride is also compatible with self-hate. He says Spinoza didn't really get that. And then he says, here's where he comes to a very important point about hope again. Let me sort of summarize it without reading the quotes. He says, really, what you're preaching is a kind of quietism, because hope, especially if it's hope in what seems to be, you know, unreasonable or unfounded, you know, beyond this realm of fear and desire, you're just telling people to have some hope and not do anything. And Marcel's response is, that seems completely backwards. Hope is active. Hope doesn't just sit there and wait around for something to happen. He says, the idea of inert hope seems to me a contradiction in terms. Hope is not a kind of listless waiting. It underpins action or runs before it, but it becomes degraded and lost once the action is spent. And he says, it has affinities not with desire, but with the will. The will implies the same refusal to calculate possibilities, or at any rate suspends this calculation. Could not hope therefore be defined as the will when it is made to bear on what does not depend on itself? That's a really interesting way to think about things. When we will, when we think about the will, we often think of, you know, producing things out of ourself. We're self-moved movers. It's this capacity of self-determination. But really, and Marcel, along with some other reflective philosophers like Maurice Blondel, really stressed this aspect of the will. To will is very often to will to cooperate with something else that also supplies the power, the capacity, the resolution to what it is that we're looking for. One can will what does not depend on oneself. So he says, what's the experimental proof of this connection? The most active saints carry hope to the highest degree. The mistake, he thinks, so often made here comes from a stoical representation of the will as a stiffening of the soul, when really what the will is a way of relaxing to cooperate with things. Relaxation and creation. And now he's moving into something else, another theme in talking about creation. So I want to stop here for just a moment and, you know, call attention once again to the fact that what he's done here is he's taken this essentially Christian conception of hope, but not one that's exclusively Christian, and contrasted it as a comportment within the mystery to despair. The realm of hope and the realm of fear and desire is the realm of the problem, the realm of technics, the realm of the functional, the realm of objectivity. This is something beyond it, which doesn't mean that it's incapable of analysis, but it means that we have to recognize, as we're reading Marcel, that we ourselves are implicated in this, that we ourselves are on some level, whether we realize it or not, choosing between these. Now we come to two terms that Marcel is bringing together and which many people would want to separate out from each other. He, in fact, actually has an entire book called Creative Fidelity, which is well worth reading. Why are these terms something that many people would perceive as antinomic? Well, because, as he says, you know, fidelity implies a sort of constancy, and creativity implies a kind of spontaneity, a kind of doing otherwise. So how can these be together? How can fidelity not, in fact, cut off creativity? You know, if you choose, I'm going to, well, think about, he doesn't use this example, but I'll use this example because I think a lot of people can probably relate to it. Think of sexual fidelity within a monogamous relationship, particularly a marriage. One of the things, and we make movies about this, is that when you're committing, you're saying, I'm only going to have sex and have intimacy, which is something more than sex, with this person. And that might be for another 60 years. I'm cutting myself off from this whole other field of possibilities. And, you know, maybe I have desires that they don't actually share. Maybe, who knows, maybe I have kinks that they're just not going to be into and will actually find repellent. And I'll have to, like, suppress that part of myself. And then pretty soon it's going to fall into a routine. And then we'll have to, you know, maybe buy some books or some marital aids to spice things up, you know, read some, you know, pick up at the supermarket line, Cosmo's sex tips or something like that. I'm being very silly here, but I'm doing that in order to call attention to a conception of fidelity that oftentimes people import to discussions about this, that fidelity means routine, sterility, things being set in stone forever. Whereas, you know, when we think of creativity, we think of, yeah, I'm going to make new things, I'm going to try things out, I'm going to, you know, experience and do everything different the next time around. And really both of those are mistaken, because fidelity is, in fact, creative, faithfulness. And creativity does, in fact, require fidelity if it's going to have any roots. So he says, faithfulness is in reality the exact opposite of inert conformism. It is the active recognition of something permanent, not formally after the manner of a law, but ontologically. So it's a recognition. Something lasting, something permanent. Says it refers invariably to a presence or something which can be maintained within us and before us as a presence, but which ipso facto can just as well be ignored, forgotten, and obliterated. And this brings up the menace of betrayal. It's always possible for the one who is faithful up until this point to betray. You know, a classic biblical instance of this, you know, from the Gospels, St. Peter, about whom, you know, in the Gospels, Christ has said, you are the rock on which I'm going to establish my church. And although Peter every once in a while says some things that appear to be, you know, dumb, he also gets it right in a lot of, you know, respects. And he's one of the most privileged members of the circle. And yet, you know, he's told, you're going to deny me. And he's like, oh, no way. No, I will not. Everybody else might, but not me. And he does it. And he weeps when he realizes it. It's always a possibility. Betrayal. So he says, it may be objected that we often speak of fidelity to a principle. That's not really fidelity. Fidelity to a principle. He says, that's an arbitrary transposition of its notion. Principle, insofar as it's a mere abstract affirmation, can make no demands on me because it owes the whole of its reality to the act by which I sanction or proclaim it. So this means that it's something personal. It involves what Marcel calls presence. Fidelity to a principle is actually idolatry, he says. And so he says, so little is fidelity akin to the inertia of conformism that it implies an active and continuous struggle against the forces of interior dissipation. To keep oneself from betraying, against the sclerosis of habit. I may be told this is nevertheless more than active conservation, which is the opposite of creation. And he says, I think we have to go further into the nature of fidelity and presence. What is presence? When we're using this term presence here, This has a very definite meaning for Marcel. Presence is not merely an idea that I have of something before me. He says, it's of the nature of presence as presence to be uncircumscribed. Our ideas, you know, correspond to given sets of concepts, you might say, or to experiences. They are, to a certain degree, circumscribed. Something that really has presence cannot fully be given in any set or one given experience or in our concept of it. You know, think of some of the things that you have yourself experienced, perhaps natural beauty, perhaps even the presence that animals have. My cat, or I have two cats actually, are not reducible, and they're very different from each other, all of those sisters. They're not reducible merely to my memories of them, my experiences of them. There's something there that overflows that, that goes beyond that. So he says, fidelity is the active perpetuation of presence, of the renewal of its benefits, of its virtue, which consists in a mysterious incitement to create. Now, it doesn't all have to be artistic creation. You know, I'm going to go and make some new music, or, you know, I'm going to paint. I'm going to make some brilliant artwork. Giving a person a massage could be an act of creative fidelity. Smiling at people who are having a crappy day, even when you're having a crappy day, can be an act of creative fidelity. Reading through Plato once again and marveling at some of the ideas in it and drawing something out of it and thinking about the fact that you're able to communicate with somebody who wrote 2300, actually more than that, years ago and had these ideas that have been carried forth into the present. Those are acts of creative fidelity. And he has a really interesting example here. He talks about something that seems to be the exact opposite of presence to us. Death. He says, we're here at the opening of a vista whose term death will appear as the test of presence. He says, this is an essential point. We want to consider it carefully. Some people will say, look, death is merely a biological phenomenon. The body dies, it breaks down, it decomposes. It's not a test. Marcel says, it is what it signifies, and moreover, what it signifies to a being who rises to the highest spiritual level to which it is possible for us to attain. It's evident if I read in the newspaper of the death of Mr. So-and-so, who is for me nothing other than a name, this event for me is nothing more than the subject of an announcement. But it's very different in the case of a being who's been granted to me as a presence, those who have actually been parts of our lives. In this case, everything depends on me, on my inward attitude in maintaining this presence, which could be debased into an effigy. You know, it's really striking when you go to funerals, and I've been to a lot of funerals because I've had a lot of people die. I've even delivered a lot of elegies. You often hear people say, oh, you know, they're with us in spirit. So long as we keep their memories alive, you know, they're always part of our lives. And yes and no. Marcel would say it depends on our fidelity to them. As a matter of fact, even before somebody dies, you can turn them into an effigy in your mind just by not allowing them to be who they actually are and insisting that they are this person that you think them to be. And we often do this, you know, partly in many different ways. But he thinks that that's something that we ought to try to move away from. And after somebody's died, for example, you know, after somebody dies, you're never really supposed to say bad things about them. But that is, you know, part of who they are. That's what's nice about going to real funerals with families that are actually close and intact. You hear all the dirt on the people who died sooner or later. And that makes them actually more living for you, more real. It continues their presence. He says, It's very different in the case where fidelity is creative in the sense I have tried to define. A presence is a reality. It's a kind of influx. It depends on us to be permeable to this influx, but not to tell the truth, to call it forth. Creative fidelity consists in maintaining ourselves actively in a permeable state. It requires struggle to keep ourselves available, to keep ourselves open. And what we're doing in carrying that sort of thing out is really making space within ourselves and within our lives and within our experience and within our sets of projects and concerns for others and for the presence that they bring, which is not something that can be confined to just this. And so now you can see this is simply not compatible with a bureaucratic approach to things, or even with a selfish approach to things, an individualistic, you have your space over there, I have my space over here, don't trespass. We do trespass upon each other by living, by existing within the same world, by sharing meanings. And creative fidelity means this maintained effort that really, you know, would require something ultimately like a virtue in order to do well, to avoid falling into types of betrayal, avoid falling into what he called that, you know, sclerosis of habit, to maintain ourselves open. And this brings us to this notion of availability that Marcel has, develops, brings out. That brings us to another element. We've talked about hope. We've talked now about faith in terms of fidelity. Now we're going to talk about charity. Marcel is clear that when he is talking about availability, the French term for which is, I've got it over here, disponibilité, being at the disposal of another being, being open, being ready, being available to another, that what he's talking about here is what Christian authors mean when they are discussing, at least if they know what it is, charity. Reminds me of something Augustine actually once said, which is that there are old women who have never read the scriptures and who have not, you know, done any theology of their own, but who actually know charity better than the theologians, better than the scripture scholars, because they experience it and live it, and they do so in an active way. That's what he's talking about here. And another term for it is love. When in Greek they say agape, that's what gets translated in Latin as caritas, which we have as charity. So we're talking about all these things together. Marcel is going to focus on this notion or this aspect of availability. Availability in what sense? So when we have the presence of another, of a being, like we said, it overflows our experiences, our concepts. There's an influx. And he says, at this point, somebody might object to me and say, all right, you've now ceased to decorate a psychological platitude with metaphysical ornaments, but only to make a gratuitous assertion which is unproven and beyond all experimental proof. This is inevitable as soon as you replace the ambiguous and neutral term presence by the even more compromising term influx. He says, well, if we want to reply to this, we must refer again to what I've already said about mystery and recollection. It's only on the meta-problematical level that the notion of influx can possibly be accepted. This is not something which can be dealt with as a problem in the realm of objectivity, reduced to something that is handleable by a technics, a technology, a technique, a discipline conceived of in scientific ways. It's not something that you could actually bring into managerial theory either, or organizational behavior. So he says, when I say that a being is granted to me as a presence or a being, or as a being, this means that I am unable to treat him as if he were placed merely in front of me. Between him and me there arises a relationship which in a sense surpasses my awareness of me. It's not like this. Here's me, and here's the other being. Rather, the other being enters into me to a certain degree. Doesn't just touch me, touches within me. He says, he is not only before me, he is within me, or rather these categories themselves are transcended. These images are not actually that useful. They no longer have any meaning. The word influx, it helps to bring across a kind of interior accretion, an accretion from within, which comes into being as soon as presence is effective. When I am actually open to another's presence, there's an inescapability of them within me, within my very being, within my realm of action, choices, projects, that requires me to either take them into consideration or to betray them in one way or another. So he says, we have to conceive of this as with me. They are with me. They have a co-presence with me. Note the metaphysical value of this word, so rarely recognized by philosophers, which is neither a relationship of inherence or immanence, nor a relationship of exteriority. It is of the essence of the genuine co-esse. He says, I have to use the Latin word. That is of genuine intimacy. So influx, another way of thinking about this, is in terms of intimacy. And, you know, he's not just talking about sexual intimacy, of course. There's an intimacy involved in reading and actually understanding Marcel. There's an intimacy involved in participating rather than just merely consuming the play that the actors are put on, you know, participating in it by as an audience member. There's an intimacy involved in eating the meal that has been prepared for a person lovingly and plated and proffered in a sort of, you know, granting way that they actually took account of your presence in developing it. So he says, it must be added, and this brings us to the verge of another sphere, that the value of such intimacy, particularly in relation to the living and the dead, will be the more higher and the more assured, the more that this intimacy is grounded in the realm of total spiritual availability, that is to say, of charity. So he says, let's analyze this notion of availability then. And he says, it's an undeniable fact, though it's hard to describe in intelligible terms, that there are some people who reveal themselves as present. And this is Marcel's way of talking about something that we do have a grasp on, that we use other terms in. When somebody is present to you, when somebody's a good listener, for example, they don't just do the verbal, make eye contact, nod every once in a while, say the right things. You can do that sort of stuff and still not be listening to somebody. I mean, you can get very good at that, actually. Some people do. You can feel that person is not present, is not available. There are some people who reveal themselves as present, that is to say, at our disposal. Here's another great example. When we clean for each other. You know, I'm from the kind of background where I've worked as a janitor, I've worked as a dishwasher, I've cleaned tables, you know, and bussed them and things like that, and I know what that's like. And I'm very conscious about trying to minimize the mess that I make, because I know how hard a lot of people in those jobs work and how little appreciated they are. And when they you know, somebody comes over and cleans my table, I make sure to say thank you and not in a perfunctory way. Sometimes I don't do it if I'm distracted, and I have to admit, but I try to do that. And that's, in a certain respect, my, you know, sort of granting an acknowledgement of the value of what it is that they're doing. And they're doing for me. And some people, you know, don't know how to They don't know what to make of them. I also, you know, when I'm walking in hotels, I say, you know, good morning, and sometimes chit chat with the housekeeping. And you know, if they're having a bad day, they may say, you know, the equivalent of screw off, or you know, you shouldn't have made that mess, or. And some of them think that they're you know, far too good to be doing that sort of stuff. There's many, particularly if you get into a town that has lots of actors, you know, or college students who are just, you know, in their view, slumming for a time. But many people who do those sorts of things feel, they give you that sense of presence. They are available for you. They're like, yeah, well, we make messes. That's why I've got this rag here. Let me just, you know, clear this off for you. Have a good day. Enjoy your meal. That is what Marcel is talking about, as being present. So he says, you know, when we're in pain or need to confide in someone, when there are other people who don't give us this feeling, however great their goodwill is, they're not present. And he says, the difference between presence and absence is not the same thing as that between attention and distraction. Some people who are present are not like paying attention to you constantly, but they are there for you. He says, the most attentive and most conscientious listener may give me the impression of not being present. He gives me nothing. He cannot make room for me in himself, whatever the material favors are which he's inclined to grant me. The truth is, he says, there is a way of listening which is a way of giving. And another way of listening, which is a way of refusing oneself. The material gift, the visible action, do not necessarily witness to presence. And the same thing goes actually for gift giving. There are ways of giving small, humble gifts that are thoughtful and may not even, you know, you may not even know the person who you're giving it to. And so you're incapable of actually thinking, what would they really, really desire? But there's ways of giving that are really giving, and there's ways of giving and refusing at the same time. Here you go, but I don't want to be involved with you. So he goes on and he says, it'll maybe make this clear if I say the person who's at my disposal is the person who's capable of being with me with the whole of himself when I am in need. The one who is not at my disposal seems merely to offer me a temporary loan based on his resources. I'll give you this much, and then you're on your own, Jack. That's being unavailable, even if you are helping somebody out. True availability is to say, yeah, okay, what do you need from me? For the one, I am a presence. For the other, an object, he says. Presence involves a reciprocity, which is excluded from any relation of subject to object or of subject to subject object. And he says, now let's think about unavailability, because we understand betrayal and denial and these other things based on that. Unavailability, the lack of this, is always, he says, rooted in some measure of alienation. Say, for example, I'm told of some misfortune with which I'm asked to sympathize. I understand what I've been told. I admit in theory the sufferers deserve my sympathy. I see it's a case in which it would be logical and just for me to respond with sympathy. I even offer my sympathy, but only with my mind. Because when all is said and done, I feel obliged to admit I feel absolutely nothing. I'm sorry that this is so. The contradiction between the indifference which I feel in fact and the sympathy which I know I ought to feel is humiliating and annoying. It diminishes me in my own eyes. But it is of no use. What remains in me is the awareness that, after all, these are people I do not know. This is only a case. Number 75627. It is no good, I can feel nothing. The characteristic of the soul, he says, that is at the disposal of others, is that it doesn't look at them as cases. It looks at them as presences. As others. He says, our very development as human being implies a distinction between what's your business and what's my business and what I have to be concerned with and what you have to be concerned with. And there is a sense of alienation there, a sense of splitting apart. And a lot of things contribute to this. You know, the way in which we divide up labor in the workplace, the fact that we've outsourced so much of our production, the ways in which we relate to each other in conditions of service, the ways in which we carry out education. You know, it's interesting. To a certain extent, there's a greater availability, a greater possibility of acknowledging the presence of others by the, you know, the online education and course management systems that we use. But they can also be used to set up barriers. Don't bother me. I've given you what you need. I've given you everything you need to succeed. Now, do your work and give me this product over here, but I don't want to hear your other stuff. That's a way of not being present, of unavailability to my students. So he says, there's a tendency in all of us to become, you know, the center of a sort of mental space arranged in concentric circles of decreasing interest and participation. It's as though each one of us had secreted a kind of shell which gradually hardened and imprisoned him. And he says, fortunately, we can have encounters that break through these shells, which, you know, a chance encounter with a stranger, an opportunity to actually do something good, to alleviate some harm, can break through this and allow us to not, I won't say experience, but actually enact availability. And he notes something else. He says, to be incapable of presence is to be in some manner not only occupied with, but encumbered with one's own self. It's the self, not as, you know, that you would face your identity altogether, but the self as sort of, you know, taken to a higher degree, as you know, constantly navel-gazing and concerned with its own affairs, that cuts us off from this, being encumbered with one's own self. And he says, I've said in some manner the immediate occupation, the preoccupation may be anything. I can be preoccupied with my own health. You know, oh, I gotta get in my walking. Sorry, I can't listen to you. Gotta get in my, you know, 10,000 steps. My fortune, wealth, concern for the security of my own family. Even with my own inward perfection. And you see many people who are, you know, using techniques that are supposed to actually make them more available to other people. You know, yoga is a great example of this, the namaste, go screw yourself kind of attitude that many people have, which goes totally contrary to the actual, you know, teachings of Patanjali about yoga and ethics. You know, the same thing with many people who espouse Christianity but are lacking in charity, lacking in love for other people, lacking in this capacity to be available and present to another person's presence. He says, if we go on and we think about this, there's a kind of obduracy or fixation here, and perhaps by, you know, doing something like psychoanalysis, we could dig into it and break up some of these hardened parts of a person. And he says that there's something else going on here, though, as well. He says there's a kind of disquiet, an indefinite disquiet, and which it should be identified with the anguish of temporality and our being towards death. So here Marcel is actually sort of veering towards Heidegger and Sartre and people like that. And he's talking about pessimism. He says, pessimism is rooted in the same soil as the inability to be at the disposal of others. If the latter, the inability to be at the disposal of others, grows in us as we grow old, it's only too often because as we draw near to what we regard as the end of our life, anxiety grows to the point of choking us. And for many of us, that can be our legacy. What am I leaving behind? You know, and so I've got to think about what I'm going to leave to my children, my grandchildren, my spiritual heirs, or pick whatever. And then you're not available to them. You've got to work on these projects and get in those last things. But really, as your time grows shorter and shorter, you want to be more and more available to people. He says, the capacity to hope diminishes in proportion as the soul becomes increasingly enchained to its experience and the categories that arise from it. There is, we experience what he calls that sclerosis of habit, right? And it is given more and more completely to the world of the problematical. He says, now we can actually bring all these themes together. And he says, I've got to address an issue that comes up here, and particularly in terms of charity, he says, a serious objection remains to be mentioned. It will be said that all you've actually said here implies an unformulated reference to the data of Christianity and can only be understood in light of these data. So we understand what you mean by presence if we think about the Eucharist, you know, for Catholics, right? The real presence, also for Orthodox, also for Lutherans, for Anglicans. And what you mean by creative fidelity if we think of the church. But what can be the value of such a philosophy for those who are not Christian, who are a-Christian, he says, for those who ignore Christianity or who do not accept it? And Marcel's answer is, you know, I came up with these ideas before I converted. It's true that knowing something about the history of Christianity sure helps you figure out a lot of these issues. You know, reading St. Bernard on love isn't going to get you, you know, steered astray, because he's going to talk about this, understanding what Anselm had to say about love. You know, these are very helpful things. And he says, it's quite possible the existence of the fundamental Christian data may be necessary, in fact, to enable the mind to conceive some of the notions I've attempted to analyze. But these notions themselves do not depend on a person being a Christian. I had these ideas and I was working these out long before I converted, 20 years before them. And he says, on the other hand, should I be told the intellect must leave out of account anything which is not a universal data of thinking as such, I would say that's foolish. That's illusory. That's actually to confine things to the problem rather than to the realm of the mystery, which is what we've been exploring this entire time. And he says, what's going on here is that Christian ideas have taken on, and experiences have taken on, what he calls the role of a fertilizing principle. It favors the development of certain ideas which we might not have conceived without it. This development may take place in what we call para-Christian zones. For myself, I experienced it more than 20 years before I had the remotest thought of becoming a Catholic. He's speaking about his own idea. So what have we done here? We have laid out this entire, you know, sort of thumbnail sketch of Marcel's projects as a whole by looking at his conception of the ontological mystery. He thinks that we do need to pay attention to concepts like presence, like availability, things that cannot be reduced to the problematical, things that are not going to fit into philosophy if philosophy is conceived of as just, you know, adjunct to the sciences or modeled after the sciences, or, you know, what is universally valid for all people, regardless of what sort of choices, what sort of comportments they have, whether they reflect on their experience, whether they don't. By actually thinking out what the mystery means and how it's related to things like charity, to availability, we come to understand what philosophy is supposed to be like.